In this video, you've got your H2B visa. Now, how do you find the workers?
Coming up after the break. On this channel, we help immigrants get reliable information so they can make better decisions and avoid costly mistakes, and we do that for employers employing immigrants as well. Now, foreign recruiters are a particular subspecialty of professional in the H2B process that are often mentioned in news and information that USCIS puts out about the H2B visa, but they're very poorly understood, even by immigration lawyer societies. And so we're going to kind of give you the inside scoop on why these recruiters are important, how you should work with them, and maybe how you should think about your relationship with them and your relationship with the firm as one big symbiotic organism.
If you've watched our other videos, you probably recall we advise using a recruiter. And the reason we do that, in summary, is you've received your temporary approval from the Department of Labor. Now you file your I-129. You receive that final certification. Now you have to figure out where your workers are going to come from. You've received your temporary approval from the Department of Labor. Now you file your I-129. You receive that final certification. Now you have to figure out where your workers are going to come from. How do you find those workers? What happens if a worker gets denied? This is where the foreign recruiter comes in. This foreign recruiter that you hire is going to contact potential employees or beneficiaries in whatever country you've designated. They're going to find these workers for you. Typically, what we've seen is that recruiters charge maybe around $150 per worker. So if you have, you know, four workers, you're looking at about $600. And after experiencing a few H2B cycles, we can assure you it's well worth it.
So why are recruiters so valuable?
Recruiters are valuable for a number of reasons. First off, they know the market. They know whatever country you've designated that you want to bring beneficiaries from. They're going to understand that market, that those employees. They're going to be able to go out and find more potential beneficiaries for you. Additionally, they're going to guide those beneficiaries through the application process.
And as lawyers, we can't appreciate that enough, because the process on the in-country side, where you're getting your workers from, is very specific to country conditions, and I would hate to have to do that on our own.
And as I mentioned, recruiters do charge a fee per worker. However, if that worker falls through, they're not going to charge you an additional fee to go find another worker. That fee is only for approved workers. So, you know, if a bad apple applies that, you know, their screening process doesn't catch for whatever reason, then they'll go out and find you someone better.
And we should mention that the best recruiters, the ones that we use anyway, don't charge for extra folks.
Right. Some may. It's not our experience, but if you're dealing with a law firm who tells you this, maybe pressure them to find a different recruiter.
Right, and we'll try to include the name of at least one recruiter here below in the description of this video that we use and that you can look to use too.
Building on that, say they charge you $150 per person. Like I said, that's relatively cheap. Think about the hourly rate you're paying your law firm, and now let's think about international calling, maybe international texting. Not only are you paying those fees, you're also paying billable hours to a law firm. If the beneficiary is a little uncertain about what to do, these charges could add up very quickly. So if you're familiar with the H2B process at all, you know there are some pretty strict guidelines for what recruiters can, can't do. They have to be pretty straight-laced. They can't charge beneficiaries any kind of fees abroad. So how do you know if you have a good recruiter? How can you kind of figure this process out and make sure that your recruiter isn't actually going to get you, the employer, in trouble?
And one of the things that you should look out for, kind of a big green check that you need to have kind of marked off before you start, is that you should be signing a contract with your recruiter before any recruiting is done. And that contract will have pretty standard language that the Department of Labor and USCIS want to see in your recruiter agreement that will spell out, among other things, that the recruiter can't get paid by the people that she or he is recruiting. And that will also spell out certain terms of your relationship. If you don't have a contract before recruiting starts, that's a red flag.
If you have that contract, you can then search that recruiter's name against a database of recommended recruiters by the Foreign Labor Certification website. They post it every cycle, And you can pull that up and make sure that your recruiter is on that list.
And at the bottom of this video, that's another link that we have, is where you can go check to see if the recruiter that you're talking to is actually approved by DOL USCIS. If they're not, you cannot work with that worker, or you yourself could face fines and get in trouble during an audit.
Recruiters are a very valuable tool. There are resources out there that can help to assure that you're hiring a good recruiter, and they're pretty cost effective. So if your law firm tells you they use a recruiter, that probably means that it's going to save you money in the long run, even though when you see it, you may question that charge or wonder why you're paying an additional fee.
What are times that you do not want to use a recruiter?
I would say never. Even if you know the employee that you want to bring over, you have their name, you have all their information, you think it's pretty straightforward, you could even put their name on the I-129, I would still use a recruiter.
Yeah.
I wouldn't put their name on the I-129. Don't do that. That's another
topic. Video, but yeah, don't put anybody's name on the I-129, and if you want to know why, you can always call us and we'll tell you. Then if there's never a bad time to use a recruiter, what is a good way for a recruiter and an employer to work together?
The ideal situation is if you as an employer know what beneficiary you want to bring in on an H2B visa. You can give the recruiter the name, contact information, and other information like that to the recruiter. The recruiter can then contact that employee, give them directions, kind of walk them through the application process abroad, and it makes for a very smooth transaction.
Now, it's not all rosy, right? There are some downsides to recruiters. Let's get to the big one.
Kind of the biggest issue that you can run into with recruiters, and once again, this varies based on your recruiting company, but some recruiting companies don't vet the employees quite as well as you might hope. So they just take your job description, they might ask a few questions, you know, do you have experience in the industry? And whatever you answer, they kind of take it face value. So there's no real research going into that beneficiary.
And in fact, they can't legally use more than the job description you've put together for that job to ask questions of an employee. And so that runs into conflict with some of the strategies that you need to use to get certified in the first place as an employer that can bring over H2B workers. Namely, if you put in too many skills, remember this is the non-skilled, non-agricultural visa, you'll get a prevailing wage that's too high for your business. So a lot of times you're looking for low-skill workers, and that's what the recruiter is going to find you. One of the big things that we run into is that companies that are, let's say, looking for somebody with like a carpenter skill set, somebody that's getting interviewed by a recruiter, right, a potential employee will say, oh yeah, I know how to do that, I'm a carpenter. And all the recruiter will do is take them at their word, right? Mm-hmm. They'll go through the checkbox because there's no way for them really to check. So this goes back to your ideal relationship as an employee with your recruiter, where if you take some time before the recruitment time comes to locate people in your home country that you know you have those skills, and you present them as possible people to be recruited, the recruiter will take them through the process first, and if they don't work out, then they'll find somebody else that fits that description.
That is, I would say, probably not the only downside to using a recruiter, but it's really the only downside that comes to mind. As we mentioned, they're cost effective, they're gonna get you the employees. Their paycheck depends on them bringing in employees, which only leads to the only downside being. So that really is, I guess, the only real downside that immediately comes to mind with a recruiter. Like we said, they're pretty cost effective. In my opinion, they're going to save you money in the long run because you're not getting those extra billable hours from your law firm. They handle all international calling. All of those bills that can add up in a hurry are taken care of. So pretty cost effective. They tend to have, you know, their hand on the pulse of the market in whatever country you're seeking to bring employees in from. I mean, with our experience, they're pretty good at bringing in employees. We have never had a visa go unfilled. So if you get 10 H2B visas, they'll find you 10 workers. Like I said, the only downside is they can only vet based on what is in the job description, and then they can't really look beyond what the employee tells them. Which, as Dami mentioned, takes you to the ideal situation where you know some employees going in, you give those names, that contact information to the recruiter, and then the recruiter handles everything for the beneficiaries. So, if you're getting a bill from your law firm, you see that recruiter charge, just roll with it.
Yeah, just roll with it. It's saving you money and time, and it's lowering your attorney bill. There's other ways that you can save money. We've covered those in other videos. We have a whole H2B playlist that you should check out. The link is at the bottom. You can also check it out on our channel.
If you like this video, if you're interested in learning more about the H2B visa, give us a follow, check us out. We have an entire video series on the H2B visa, and that will continue to be added to as we go.
We also have a website, bullcity.lawyer, where we take some of these videos, turn them into blog posts if you're somebody who likes to read and be able to print something out. And you can always call us. We're a real place. We'd love to try and help you.